Everything you do, you place in subjection to the Most High. A person does not commonly nor ordinarily do this, unless they be broken down first. And when you are built back up again, your desire set is far different than what it was. You're a different person altogether. You truly become a new creature in Christ. So when your life is stripped and you have many losses, don't ever think that somehow you've messed up with the Lord. You're in the era or the time period of grace and mercy and not punishment. Because of that, if you are stripped of things in your life, the Lord is working with you. You see, we have a very loving Father who is also jealous. A lot of people have tried to explain this, explain being a jealous God, by their own interpretation, not having a good footing in what's called love. The only way to understand what that term means, I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity upon the fathers unto the children, unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy to the thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. The only way to understand that is for you to occupy a place in love itself, for you to not be a person of revenge or anger. You have to be a person who has great temperance, can tame his tongue. Then you'll understand what being a jealous God is for. Parents understand it to a degree. The meaning of jealousy, as far as it describes our Father, is nothing like man's jealousy. Man gets jealous over what he wants and desires, and will not suffer another to have what is his. That's man's jealousy. That's not God's jealousy. It's just like God's anger. God's anger is so pure that if you did everything right from this day forward, you wouldn't even match up. You wouldn't meet the criteria of righteousness to God's anger. Even in your best loving state, it will never happen. So we have to be careful not to take the definitions, what we think they are, and bestow them upon the Lord, personifying him to be like us. We can never do that. I'll explain God's jealousy, because a lot of people have said, how can we have a God who's jealous? Isn't that some sort of a flawed trait? God doesn't give us jealousy. He does not. But if you were to describe one of the Lord's ways to convey it to another, you would have to use common terms. You couldn't use some term they're not familiar with. You would have to use some common term they can understand. And then through context, through reading, through study, you would eventually get it. You would comprehend it beyond man's definitions. Man is prideful. Men love to control, and one form of their control is to be right, is to define things. They love that. They love to be the expert on how to define things, which is why I love the Spirit, because the spiritual definition of things supersedes man's silly thinking. Jealousy can point you in the right direction. God being a jealous God, meaning he loves you. But if you begin to love something else, there's a problem. That's where you begin, but that's by no means the description of our Father. So let me explain this to you simply. With a child, you don't care who that child loves. You care that that child will excel in life, will survive, and will ultimately make it. If anybody gets in the way of that, you may become a little angry because of your jealousy. But your jealousy at that moment is not tied to someone getting in the way of your will. It's tied to someone obstructing the path of your child. If you were able to see all elements of a child's life, you would not suffer that child to love something that would destroy him. Because the thought of having one of your children embrace something destructive and to keep, that would be an unbearable thought. God's jealousy is that he loves us so much, he will not suffer darkness to fully overtake us. He loves us so much that he'll never leave you in the hands of anybody else. God's jealousy is when you begin to love something that will destroy you, he will not suffer it. That's why they say jealous. Because when men love destructive things, they will surely die. He will not suffer that and will break us from it so that we live. See, because once all of this is over, you're going to have no memory of all this negativity that was in the world. You will remember darkness no more. It'll be gone. And because of that, the Lord will use his methods and his ways to guide and teach you to do good. That when you embrace something of darkness, he will show you how dark it really is. When you begin to see how dark something is, that's when it bites you. That's how he demonstrates to you what darkness is. Say you befriended a person who was just terrible. Nobody could tell you, hey, that person is bad. Nobody could walk up and tell you anything. You guys know this because you dated and people came up to you and said, I don't think that person's right for you. You know what you said inside? You're just jealous. You're just, you know, this. I'm not going to listen to these people. I know what I'm doing. I like this person and that's just how it is. But then as time went on and that person began to betray you and things began to happen and it ended in a disaster, that's when you said, nope, that person's no good for me. So you had to experience the truth. to accept the truth. Anybody telling you the truth, it wouldn't work. You would instantly reject it because you had no evidence that the person was evil. So what the Lord does is when you embrace anything of darkness, he will let you have experience with it all the way up until the point when it bites you. And after it bites you, he stands by because you will say, that was truly a serpent because it just bit me. I thought it was a lamb, but it bit me and it left serpent bites in my arm. It was a serpent. He stands by to heal you of that bite. But he must let you have that walk. He protects you along the way. See, these mishaps that we have in life, he's been walking with us the whole time, overseeing our lives, because we point to too many things saying it's not dark, it's not evil, it's not that bad. And so he allows us to have a walk with it. And ultimately, a serpent, no matter how many times he does not bite you, will ultimately bite you, because the characteristics and the instincts of that serpent, they will come forward one day and it will bite you. In that time when it bites you, that's when we learn serpents bite. That saying is true. And it hurts a whole lot, but the Lord stands ready to heal us. Once we learn that what we once loved and thought was good was truly darkness, we are hurt to the heart. We feel downcast in countenance. The Lord stands by and he holds us very gently. He starts to build us up in truth. Because the more darkness is exposed to us by the living God, not by man, but by the living God, the more we accept his righteousness. We begin by believing that most darkness is not darkness at all, because we just don't know. And so through life, you have plenty of experiences. When you learn what darkness truly is, and when you do, you become passionate behind that truth. But God is a jealous God, meaning he will not have you totally embrace and love something that's going to kill you. So he allows you to walk with it so that it can be exposed for what it is. And after it bites you, he embraces you and holds you. He doesn't say a word. We're the ones that say, Father, forgive me. I thought it was good and I should have listened. See, if it's one thing his children always do, and he didn't have to say a word, is he protects us through all these trials, and we're the ones that turn around to him and say, Father, forgive me, don't we? We do that on our own accord. He does not force it out of us. That's a blessing, because that's further identification of who we belong to. This gentleman that wrote in and his life was falling apart, and actually a couple other people wrote in the same thing. Their lives are falling apart. They're being shown what darkness truly is and how it does not last. How there is no confidence you can have in these man-made things. When you start losing things in your life, you have to remember something. You can never lose anything that truly belongs to you. But I tell you this, you can hold on with all your might to something that is truly not yours. And the moment you lose your grip, it's going to be gone. People hold on to things that do not belong to them all the time. And they have to hold on with all their might. But they know the moment they're not looking, or the moment they lose their grip, it's gone. They try to hold on to it for all their lives because it grants them security, makes them feel good knowing it's right there. They have access to it. You know, it gives them some sort of control. But it will always escape you because it does not belong to you. There are things that do belong to you that nobody can take away, nor can anybody steal. Those things are always yours. Now, a lot of people have not embraced what truly belongs to them in this world. They have something that does not belong to them. And the Lord gently breaks this cycle. He shows you the truth of what you have. Again, what truly belongs to you, you can never lose. So if you've been a person like me with lots of losses, you held on to lots of things that were never yours to hold on to. You cannot lose what truly belongs to you, but you will lose those things that do not belong to you. The Lord allows this. This works our experience. And do you know what he said in his scripture? Whom he called, he also qualified. Well, how were you qualified? Because all of those experiences that you've gained in life, where you could recognize darkness and evil, they then become qualifications for you to speak to those people who go through similar things. If you've been abused, and we discussed this before, you have a language for those who are being abused. Where I may miss the language of a person being abused, you will not. They capture your attention. Because the same cry that they cry, you have cried. You know where they're going through. You can actually reach them. Somebody else who has not been through abuse may say, hey, just toughen up and get over it. You would never say that. You may go up to them and say nothing. It'll be the right move. The Lord prepared you this way. God, being a jealous God, he will not suffer you to have or love anything that's going to destroy you. But in those things that have gotten close to you, that tricked you, he uses your trials, your experiences, that becomes your qualification to help free those who are in bondage to the exact same things you were. All of you who have gone through things and have lost plenty of things, that makes you a jewel in the body of Christ. And I know a third degree to this whole thing. All of you who have been abused, all of you who have had great losses in your life, Satan desires you to think that you're a failure. He wants you to think that you're just a mess up, a screw up. A That's what he wants you to think. Don't listen to him. Your father would never tell you that. Only Satan would. Only the deceiver would. Your father in heaven would never tell you that you're a failure. Only Satan would. So stop listening to Satan. If you're existing right now and you think you're a failure, you did not get that from your father nor the Holy Spirit. That was Satan. And what he does is he tries to keep you indoors, in chambers, that you never go out and be in proximity to other people because you would break the darkness off of their lives. You've been anointed to hear, to recognize, and to pray. You're a weapon. And so with any weapon, he wants that weapon to be locked up that nobody have access to it. You are a weapon for righteousness, a good weapon. And because he knows this, he attacks your mind. He'll coordinate supernatural assaults upon your life to make you feel like you're nothing. Your father never told you that. Your father never told you that you were a mess up. Your father never told you that you were nothing. Your father never told you any of those things. Satan did. Our Father tells us that we are victorious in Christ. Our Father tells us, hey, I love you, so I sent my Son to die for you. Our Father tells us, it doesn't matter how bad you've been. I stand ready to forgive through the blood of the Lamb. That's what our Father tells us. Don't listen to the lie. Listen to the truth. He's trying to keep you indoors because you can pierce and cut the darkness. If you can continue to have you think that you're nothing, that you're a loser, that you messed everything up beyond the point of repair. If he can have you believe that nothing is repairable, what you need to tell him right now is say, that's right. This stuff is not repairable because all that is broken in my life was unrighteousness, never righteousness, because righteousness does not break. And anything I've lost did not belong to me. What belongs to me, I may never lose. And the Lord will have that discovered to me as I follow him. So get behind me, Satan. That's what you tell him. You tell him that on a daily basis. When you have these thoughts come into your mind, that you're a no one, that you're a loser, that you're just messing up everything, that does not come from the throne of the living God. That is a lie. Why do you exist in the first place? And why do you believe in Christ? Because you belong to the Lord and you've been bought with a price. And if you've been bought with a price, God is watching over you. You are a vessel in his house and you will never be stolen. Remember that. And condition your minds to be within Christ. Your carnal mind will say, well, logically, I did lose because I did this, and you end up blaming yourself with it. That's fine. But you only lost those things that did not belong to you. They had no placement in your life. What Satan will never tell you is that all of your losses become experience. Experience is your wisdom, and that wisdom can assist many who are young. Somebody's going through the beginning of your process, and Satan wants to keep you in chambers so that you never get in contact with those individuals. He wants to isolate you, divide you, keep you to yourself. God never tells you to abandon the brothers. In fact, he says, forsake not the assembly of the saints together. Hallelujah. He never told you to cut them off. Satan does. Satan says, withdraw yourself from everybody. Don't communicate. That's what Satan said. Why? You may not know this, but God gave us pieces of righteousness in part. That's why we are multiple body parts in the body of Christ. We complement one another. We constitute the entire body. If Satan can cause the hand to stay in the pocket, then you only have one arm to work with. So you work with half the strength of what you could have. That's what he's doing. So understand this. The Lord is having the darkness be shown as what it really is, darkness. And these losses you have in your life, those are things that never belong to you. And it's time for you to have those things that truly do belong to you. You know when it comes from the Lord, because any blessing that the Lord gives, there's no regret connected to it. You don't end up saying, I wish I would have never had this, or I wish I would have never met that person. You never say that. Any wisdom from above is without regret. So what you learn of the Lord, you don't regret it. You know how people say, be careful what you ask the Lord for. No, that implies that you're going to learn something you'll regret. That's untrue. Wisdom from above is without regret. If you had a devious father, a tricky father, you'd have to be careful what you ask for. If your father was a practical joker, you'd have to be careful what you ask for. Let me tell you something. A good father knows not to give any child everything they ask for. A good father is pleased when a child begins to ask for those things that increase that child's responsibility as caretaker over other things. Because in the great scheme of things, we are caretakers of something or someone else. I think it's a miracle how the Lord works things. Before we accepted Christ as our personal Savior, we were thrust in darkness. We faced Satan himself. He was not able to kill us. So that when we accept Christ, We never have to venture back into darkness again. Isn't that awesome? Because most of the darkness you were involved with before you really said yes to Christ. Now, this conversation comes with a caution. Of the iniquitous things you have learned, of the darkness you have been privy to learn, venture not back into it again. I have a focus here, and that focus is on Christ and the gospel of Jesus Christ, because that is the only way you can truly be saved. There is no other way to have the victory than for you to be established in Christ. And I know that as you are established in Christ, your eyes are going to be open. You'll eventually see what I see. And when you do, you'll be mature to a point where you won't be moved either. You won't slip into the darkness. You'll just simply say, get behind me, Satan. Somebody comes out with some facts and this demon looks like this, or this fallen angel can do this. You'll say, so what? Big deal. I already know that. Let's move on. Let's talk about the goodness of the Lord. A demon will come out with 1,000 troops and you'll say, you are defeated. Get out of my way. I go in the name of the Lord. Not going to sit there wasting time giving a bunch of incantations like the demon can't hear, saying repetitious things over and over and over again. Demons are not deaf. The reason why people have to say repetitious things is because they, when a person says, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus the first time, they don't even realize they said it. It's a reaction. The second time they say it, they're probably in a fearful state. The third time, the aggression comes in, and they're probably in an angry state. They say it again and again and again until a special moment hits. And it's the moment when they mention the name of Jesus, and they're thinking about the cross. And they say, wait a minute, Jesus died for me. What am I doing? Jesus has rebuked you already. Get behind me. See, at that point, they're giving all glory to God. They realize all the power and authority is in Christ, and that demon has no choice but to comply. Because at that point, that person has evoked the kingdom authorities. But at first, they're just saying a word. At first, they're just pronouncing words. And it holds no meaning in their heart. But I'll tell you this. If you were to ever say or rebuke something in the name of Jesus, and you see Jesus up on that cross realizing he died for you, at that moment, you don't even care about the demon. You're focused upon Christ, and you understand his authority. You may, in a voice of sadness, not anger, say, get behind me, Satan. You have no power here. That's how it works. But when a person does not recognize Christ Jesus as the Christ, demons do not have to listen to you, because you're not standing in the kingdom. You're standing in the world. You're reacting by way of fear or by way of aggression. A demon does not have to listen to that. But if you're standing in the kingdom, you don't have to yell or anything. That demon's going to hear you before you can fully utter out the phrase. He'll be gone before you can finish the phrase. That's why it says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Well, that word resist is not the word resist in the way you would think. It is to not put yourself back in the world again on his playing field. But it is to stand within the kingdom, ignoring his lies, his accusations. Standing in the kingdom, that's when you stand in authority. That's why the Bible says the kingdom of God does not come with observation. No one's going to say, here it is, or lo, there it is. But the kingdom of God is within you, and you carry it everywhere you go. And that authority is real. The Lord knows what he's doing concerning life or death. So when it comes to great tribulation, that is the test that comes upon the whole face of the earth. And if it's a test, it's a qualification to see if you love the Lord with all of your heart, with all of your mind, with all of your soul. And since that is the case, then the Lord's going to see what you're willing to give up to choose him. And because that is a case as spoken of by the prophets, we know that a type of a person leaving materialistic things is going to come. People will be upset because they don't have their materialistic comforts. And in that moment, a lot of people will choose materialism over the living God. They're going to want their comforts over salvation. They talk about salvation now. They talk about the Lord now because they're comfortable. A time is coming where there will be no comfort. And in that day, you will know who truly loves the Lord or not of those who are alive in that day. But as far as tribulation is concerned, you're born into it. That's my belief. How do you know if your name has been taken out of his book? How do you know for sure? Well, if you no longer believe in Jesus Christ, you are not in the book of life. Now, many of us have been foolish and have gotten angry at God and have said certain things, but the truth is, we rely upon Christ. It is impossible for a person who is written in the book of life to not believe in Yahshua HaMashiach. That is something God puts in you. So so that you can be kept as a belief in Christ. That's not something we do on our own. But when you are stricken out of the book of life, God gives you over to the flesh. You will not have your belief in Yeshua anymore. When you do not believe in Christ Jesus, in truth, you're not written in the book of life. Your names can be blotted out. The question is, will your names be blotted out? Revelation is a blessing, not a curse. It's only a curse and scare to those who do not want to follow the Lord. It is the book of a conclusion. It is the ultimate work of Christ. It is the will of God. It is a prophecy of fulfillment, a verdict of truth, a blessing to all who read it. I know the Lord is keeping it. And if He so decides that it's time for me to go, then nothing on earth is going to stop that process. But if it's not time for me to go, I can serve the Lord with an upright heart without the fear most people have. Don't be frightened of all these things in the earth. Your Father allows them to do what they do. They follow His instruction. Never forget that. All things are subject unto the Lord, and He made all things subject unto you. You can tread upon scorpions and serpents. You have all power over the enemy, and nothing will by any means hurt you. Just stay in the path of Christ. Stay in the path of the Lord, and you won't have these worries. But let me tell you something. There are Christians that don't believe in Christ. They spew their rhetoric on a daily basis. They politicize everything. And then you have Christians who actually start listening to that. You're of a different breed. You're believers. That's why you were born with a belief. You know you were born with a belief. Don't become like something you're not, as the Lord said. He comes back and He finds people in strange garments, garments that are not evil or righteous. There's something else, strange garments, something man has fully invented himself. Don't be found in those. My goodness, you're ambassadors to Christ. The real vaccine is Christ Jesus. You can walk right through the valley of the shadow of death and fear no evil because the Lord is with you. But do you really believe that? Because if you don't believe the Lord is with you, then you're not doing all you can do to obey the Lord. That's a fact. I've been there before when I was not doing all I could do to obey the Lord. I used to second guess, is He going to protect me or not? I don't even care now. If the Lord says go, I go. I don't care about protection or any of those things. And I've been walking that way for quite some time. And He has never failed to uphold His scriptures. I'm the one who failed to stand on His scriptures. If you stand on His word will stand for you. What you do today is what you will do. The heart you have today is the heart you have. I'm going to tell you guys something. When a person talks to you and they tell you what they will do, that doesn't work. What a person is doing today, the mindset they have today, is what they'll stand in. Why is the media delaying the position of the world events? Well, because the media, if you notice, the media serves governmental parties. You guys know the media was infiltrated by the CIA a long, 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 long time. They used to have little things they would do. The CIA did. It's gone beyond that now. It's run by money. Media is governed by money. All those guys up there doing media, they're getting paid a lot of money. Who's paying the money? Advertisers. That's who's paying the money. The folks who get the ads. So look at the commercials. Find out who the holding corporations are, and you'll find out where the money's coming from. Those same corporations are the ones that are in government. They're sitting there and they say, hey, if you pass this bill, we're going to give you kickbacks on this. And so the government, they pass bills and laws that allow certain companies to continue to grow, and then people get kickbacks. Because a senator does not make that much money. They shouldn't be millionaires. They should be middle class Americans, serving Americans, not millionaires. They're serving corporations. And so long as people continue to sit up there and believe that somehow they're for the people, when's the last time they talked to you? They're for the people, but they didn't get your opinion. They didn't discuss anything with you, did they? No, they didn't. You got to understand the whole paradigm here. It's almost like every election, you have these people that tell lies and they tell everything they're going to do. And they do a little piece of it. People are fine with that, but they never do the whole thing. And then every other election, the other guy tears down what the guy did prior to it. There's no advancement in that. People continue to believe the nonsense. The media is an extension of politics by other means. It is paid for speeches. That's it. They get the smartest people to believe in certain paradigms, and then those people tell the news with all their heart, but they're believing in these corrupt causes. They sway the masses. That's why ratings pay money. If they're talking about a subject and they don't get a lot of ratings, they will not talk about that subject again. It is scrubbed. They like controversy and drama. They will not talk about wholesome things because that doesn't bring ratings. People want to see blood coming off people. That's what they want to see. It's all about money. People are serving money. If they told the truth, no one wants to watch the truth. They don't want to hear the truth. The truth is boring. They want to hear how somebody messed up. They want to hear the dirt that somebody has on somebody else. That's what they want to hear. They want to hear the drama. They have to have their drama soup. That's why they have gladiator games, which is, you know, football, basketball, all those games where they watch people tear each other's heads off to be a winner. And that's why the world is so fixated on being a winner, because they don't know how to lose. That's ultimately going to cost us a lot. We have forgotten how to lose. We've been sitting in our chairs of kingship for so long, we have gotten fat and useless. We make more demands now, we're not innovating. All the while, our military is suffering. The numbers are down. The morale is down in the military. Do you guys know it's hard to recruit people now? And of the people you have recruited, they don't want to go to war. We have a problem that nobody has ever seen before. We do. So that's where we are.